Our next speaker is an amazing human being. I don't know the exact number, but I'm sure I'm not way off. So far this year, he's done like over 300 television interviews. He is telling the story that we've been talking about this weekend in the most profound way in areas that we don't even know exist. He frequently speaks with the medical community and hospitals and researchers and chiropractors and is having a profound effect on healthcare, wellness care, brain-based care all over the world. A fellow New Yorker, a terrific, terrific colleague, please help me stand, welcome, and give our love and energy to Dr. Rob Melillo.
Thank you. Thank you. Testing, thank you. Okay. Thank you very much. As always, I have a lot of information in a short period of time. Some of this may be repetitive for some of you, but this is the type of material that you need to hear over and over and over again. So, again, this is about changing the game. It's about changing the game by really changing your focus and changing your paradigm, which means not thinking about the spine, but thinking about the brain. Again, first I want to start off by thanking Bob and Dennis. I want to thank you because you're here. And that is always a sacrifice. You sacrifice by being here. So, I always respect that. I always respect your time. Your time is equally as valuable as mine. And I'm here because you spend your time. So thank you again for that. And thank you for taking the effort and bringing our profession forward. A lot of what I'm going to talk about are things that you can use and implement in your practice. This book, Disconnected Kids, I'm actually working on the second edition, literally this morning, because actually my deadline is tomorrow. Guess what? I'm going to miss that deadline, but that's okay. So this is the second edition. You don't get a second edition if the first edition isn't doing pretty well. So this book has been a really big seller. It's being used by many different people, teachers. It's one of the most recommended books in special education. And a lot of people just choose to use this in their practice, meaning they work with kids and they then give the book to the parents and say, here, do this at home. Let the parent do the assessment and it works. Reconnected Kids is really, as the brain is changing, there are going to be dramatic changes in behavior, and you need to be able to have the parent prepared for that. They came to you for change, but when they start to see that change, they get nervous, especially if it looks negative. So this is really all about that. This book is a book that's the latest book that came out in 2013, which is really about what causes autism. What are the environmental risk factors? How do you measure those risk factors? And how do you then eliminate them or avoid them in a measurable way so that literally we may be able to prevent a couple from having a child with autism? I'm going to be putting together a course for clinicians soon that's going to teach you how to incorporate this in your practice. How many people would be interested in that? Yeah, it's a pretty cool thing. Let me tell you, preconception prevention is the future. You mark my words, you're going to hear it all the time. This is where the research is going to go. The next book besides I got two books coming out next year, the second edition, but the next book after that is a book I'm doing with a number of celebrity chefs, including Zach Brown, who's a good friend of mine, and we're doing a cookbook, a diet and nutrition book for special needs families. So that's going to be coming out at the end of next year. I have a number of textbooks. I have Neurobehavioral Disorders of Childhood. It's really a book that if you want to get into the science, if you really want to understand at the nitty-gritty level what chiropractic is, what an adjustment does, how our brains got this way, why bipedalism is related to our brain development, and you want to understand all of the different modalities that I use and that you can use in your practice, and what is the actual science behind it, like using light or colors or music or OT or nutrition or a chiropractic adjustment. That's what that textbook's all about. It's used at UCLA Medical School. It's used in a number of medical schools. It's used in neuropsych programs around the world. It's been translated into Chinese and Korean. And it's a book that if you really want a PhD level in what we do, that's the book to go to. I've also written about 10 chapters in other books that have come out. Now, I know that some of you may have heard me last time, and some of you may have read my book, so don't answer if you don't. But if I was to ask a question of you, how many of you feel like you could comfortably stand up right now and actually tell everybody what is actually happening in the brain of a child or an adult with autism or ADHD or OCD or dyslexia? How many of you, just raised by a raise of hands, how many of you feel you could stand up and really give a good scientific explanation for that? Okay, and one is Nick, and Nick and I went to high school with each other, so it's just, it has to be something from our high school that you know, we were given this information. All right, how many of you, right, the nuns, yes, yeah, just the scrambled eggs. How many of you are chiropractors and do adjustments? How many of you want to have a brain-based practice? Okay, how many of you could also stand up and tell me or tell us what an adjustment actually does to the brain? Okay, that's a problem, right? Meaning that if you want to actually work with a condition, if you want to say you treat something, and if you want to say that your modality is going to change something, don't you think you should have a clue as to what they are or what you're doing, right? So I can really teach you that because I've spent all my career looking at that. And what qualifies me, this is a paper that was published in the Journal of Autism and Developmental Disorders in October. It's a special edition that they did called The Pathophysiology of Autism, which means that it was supposed to be a defining issue as what was the current state of the art as far as what do we know about what's happening in the brain of autism. And I had a paper in that actual journal and in that edition. So at this point, I can tell you that I do know that as well as anybody in the world. So I am qualified now to say that I'm one of the world experts in actually knowing what's happening in the brain of autism. And I can also tell you exactly what an adjustment does to the brain and how it can actually change this autism or ADHD. As I said, the one thing that I think, two things I think chiropractors that we haven't done a good job of, one is research and the other is using the media. I mean, do you ever really see a lot about chiropractic other than that idiot that's in that show, Two Men or whatever it is, and a kid or whatever, where he makes us look like a fool? But other than that, where are the shows about chiropractic? Where are the shows about what we do? Where are the shows about how we can help people?
And we're literally seeing an epidemic of these issues in the United States right now.
Dr. Robert Melillo is the co-founder of Brain Balance Centers.
One out of every 10 children in the United States now is diagnosed with ADHD, and that's a real increase.
My name is Dr. Robert Melillo. My life's mission is to help kids and families with special needs. My wife, Carolyn, makes it all possible. Welcome to our family.
So my wife and I just launched the show for special needs community, giving real information. We've done 10 episodes, we're doing 2 more episodes, and then we go out in July to film a pilot because we believe it's going to become a national show on a major network, hopefully. So we'll see what happens, I'll keep you posted. But it's about going out and trying to give people real information. Everywhere I go, the general public is desperate for real information about what's happening to their children, what's happening to their now adults. We had another attack last night in Seattle, right? You heard about that, where another person went and killed people. I did about 30 interviews in the last couple of weeks on this murder that happened in California with the kid that had Asperger's. Unfortunately, as I said then, as I said with Megyn Kelly, after Newtown, you're going to see a lot more of this stuff, more and more, because it's what's happening to children's brains. And even though this is a rarity, when you have more and more people with different types of disabilities, there's a greater percentage that may actually go there, because psychosis and schizophrenia is the same thing as autism. It's the same thing as ADHD. It's the same thing as OCD. It's just a different end of the spectrum. So for someone to go from ADHD, stick them in a basement playing video games hour on end for day after day, and guess what? They're going to turn into a psychotic state. And in that psychotic state, they may actually go out and kill people, especially if they're bullied and they've been abused or they've been neglected. So, you know, it's not that one automatically relates to the other. So again, we're talking about some big issues: autism, ADHD, developmental disorders, schizophrenia. What does chiropractic have to do with that? A lot of people in the beginning would ask me that question: why are you as a chiropractor? What does chiropractic have to do with that? You guys work with backs, right? Isn't that all that you do? So what does it have to do with behavioral disorders? And, you know, Bob and I went through this in some of our interviews that he did. But, you know, D.D. Palmer, in his original chiropractic philosophies, I probably don't have to tell you guys this, but emphasized that mental and emotional states of the patient were capable of causing disease. So what he's saying is that the brain can cause diseases. There's a downward control, and that the mental state of somebody is not just a reflection of the body, but rather it actually can create the diseases itself, including a subluxation. In 1910, his model was based on determining the causes of health and disease. And he said number one was mental or cognitive as the cause, not subluxation, but a mental or cognitive problem that may have been the result of a subluxation or could lead to a subluxation. How many of us think that way? How many of us are thinking, you know, that the brain may actually cause the subluxation, and then the subluxation can actually cause further problems in the brain or the body? It's a revolving type of system there. This is the idea of functional neurology. Is not just the fact that the body and digestive problems or immune problems or motor or sensory problems can cause brain issues, but that the brain can cause digestive problems, motor problems, sensory problems. Biological, and then he said environmental. So environmental factors are also a role. So these are all things that we need to be aware of. In 1922, the first chiropractic psychiatric hospital, the Chiropractic Psychopathic Sanitarium in Forest Park, Davenport, Iowa, was formed. In 1926, another institution for severely ill mental patients was founded, Clearview Sanitarium in Davenport. According to the former director, 60% of former patients admitted to Clearview were successfully treated, while at the same time, various state hospitals reported a 30% success rate. So just using chiropractic alone, in psychiatric hospitals, they had a double the success rate, which is, 60% even now would be a pretty phenomenal rate for success. So in 1949, the former National Chiropractic Association created the National Council on Psychotherapy at the National Convention. And when the ACA was formed, the American Council on Mental Health eventually became the ACA Council on Behavioral Health, which was basically the first council ever formed. So the first council, the first specialty in chiropractic, was really on mental health and behavioral health. That is our history. Our history is about the brain. In fact, as I've said before, when you talk about D.D. Palmer and you talk about doing an adjustment and restoring hearing, when you restore hearing, the only way you can do that is to change the brain. And what you've done is change the brain's perception of the world around you. When you make perceptual changes, you change someone's reality. Psychosis is the loss of reality. So by doing adjustments and by restoring hearing, by changing perception of our world, is it that far of a leap to say that we'll change perception of reality? Likewise, if we have something that takes us away and affects our ability to take in information or integrate information, the reality in our brain is based on the quality and our ability to process and integrate sensory information. And our actions are adaptive based on that. So it is our history. Because when you look at the brain is built on three primary systems: the optomotor, the postural, and the vestibular system. primarily the postural system. Gravity is the main driving force to the brain. Always has been. It's the reason why humans have brains. It's the reason why bipedalism does what it does, or why that is the huge step in evolution that created human consciousness, human self-awareness. But it's linked with the vestibular system and the oculomotor system. You can't separate those two. If you have an imbalance in one, it results in an imbalance in the other. Think about it. You get trauma, you have torticollis. A child is born with a torticollis, and they have a problem in their, they have a fixation or subluxation in their neck, they have a tilt. Their vestibular system is going to compensate, and then their eyes are going to compensate. You have a lazy eye, you have a problem with the eye, and the eye gets tilted, your head is going to change to be able to correct that. You have an imbalance in your vestibular system, you're going to turn your head to adjust it, which is going to change your posture, which is going to change your brain. An imbalance in all of these three systems has to result in some level of imbalance in the central nervous system in the brain, especially if it occurs during development. Because we don't, when we're born, we don't have a brain. Our brain is built from the bottom up. And movement, primarily, and movement that allows us to engage our senses is what creates this. Now, these systems are linked to the cerebellum, the basal ganglia, the thalamus, and the cortex. I can tell you all the research that's really come out, primarily in the last 20 years, 15 years, and especially the last 10 years, on what's actually happening in the brain of all of these disorders, dyslexia, ADHD, autism, schizophrenia, psychosis, and even neurodegenerative disorders, relates to this loop, the cerebellum, the basal ganglia, the thalamus, and the cortex. That loop is the loop that is affected. That loop is the loop that is unbalanced, because there are two separate loops of these systems that need to be integrated. Ultimately, when we have an imbalance or a disruption in the brain, the way that we describe it in scientific terms is a functional disconnection, meaning that there is a loss of connectivity between areas of the brain. When we say functional connectivity, and again, all the research now is about functional connectivity, what do we mean by that? We mean that it's not just physical connectivity. It's not just whether we have synaptic connections or not. It's about that the brain is really all about timing and coordination. You know, it's really neat. When I listened to Brian yesterday, and he was talking about modern vitalism, and so, you know, I went back just to make sure, and I actually Googled last night, and I wanted to see what the definition of vitalism was. And basically, it's our concept of innate intelligence, and basically that something somewhat unseen is directing our life force or controlling healing or leading us in some way. And it's really interesting because when you look at where research is going now, you know, we know about neurophysiology, we know about neuroanatomy, we know about neurochemistry, but where the real future is in what we call neurophysics, meaning quantum mechanics in the brain itself, where literally we look at the development of complex systems, complexity theory, chaos theory, and how that relates to the brain itself, which is a complex system. And so what we see is that this underlying force that we're kind of looking for really is going to come down to be as much physics as anything else. It's space and time. It's the way that we coordinate areas of our brain to work together. Coordination or timing is one of the primary aspects of functional connectivity, meaning that not areas of the brain are all physically connected to one another. They can't be. It's impossible. And especially the human brain, which is the largest brain, things are really far apart. And the key to the brain working properly is that we have to have multiple areas of the brain that work simultaneously at the exact same moment of time. So how do we get areas of the brain that are really far apart from one another to actually work together simultaneously? If we have to do it through physical connections, it's going to take too long. We can't do it. It's impossible, right? The only way we can do it is through timing. That timing itself is what coordinates it. And loss of that timing is the primary problem in all of these things. And the cool thing about it is, where do we get that timing in the brain? We got that timing in the brain because we developed that timing in the motor system as a byproduct of bipedalism. So if something affects our ability to develop that timing, that coordination in our body during development, we can't develop appropriate timing in our brain. And one of the leading theories of schizophrenia right now is what's called cognitive dysmetria. And it has to do with the cortical cerebellar thalamocortical loop. And it basically says that dysmetria means poor timing, poor coordination. It's a description we usually use for the cerebellum, which is the chiropractor's greatest friend. And the cerebellum controls posture and eye movements and vestibular input. It's where it all comes together. So chiropractic has always known about the connection between spinal and postural balance and balance of the nervous system. We've always been talking about that, right? What we are fortunately starting to realize now is that the story is much more complex and important than ever any of us ever imagined. We knew there was a relationship, but we really didn't know what it was. Nobody did. It wasn't that we were deficient. Nobody did. Imbalances in the spine and the postural system must always be connected to imbalances in the brain, either as a cause or as a result. And we are doing the research to prove and understand this better. I mean, we are doing that research, and the research is there to support that. An imbalance in the brain causes an imbalance in the spine and vice versa. This is the true nature of subluxation. Chiropractic is about the brain. It always has been about the brain. Ever since the first adjustment, it's been about the brain. When we talk about vitalism, what are we talking about? We're really talking about the brain and the way that it controls every aspect of our body. When we want to talk about true holism, you can only really understand it in reality through the brain and the nervous system. See, what I think we need to do, and listen, I'm as much, I think, you know, balance. I love to have philosophies and motivation and spirituality, but we also need reality, right? And I think what we have is we have a lot of these abstract concepts that we talk about, and we talk about it in big terms, and that's great, but we don't know the actual details. You know, the left and the right brain. The right brain sees the big picture. The left brain looks at the details. We need the details. And a lot of us, we're afraid that the details aren't really there. So that's why we avoid it. What Richard was talking about before is that fear is what motivates a lot of people. And they don't want to look forward. They want to look to the past because they're afraid of the future. And we're afraid of the future because we're afraid that science is going to disprove what we've said in the past. And I'm here to tell you, it's the exact opposite. It is proving every day more and more that what we do and what we have always said is absolutely correct. And we can stand in the room, which I have done and I do all the time, toe-to-toe with any of the top researchers, scientists, or clinicians in the world, and we will not only match them, we stand above them. If you come to IAFNR, which is our conference, we literally have the best people in the world. We have the best researchers, the best clinicians, and we have the best chiropractors. And they're on stage, and what happens every year is people come away, including those researchers, and they go, wow, you guys are unbelievable. I had no idea the level of where you guys are. You guys are so far beyond us because you have the clinical applications. It's not just about knowing knowledge, but you know how to do things about it. You know how to fix it. So when we affect the spine, we affect the brain. When we affect the brain, we affect the spine. Whether you like it or not, whether you want to know it or not, it's happening. And so I think that this is a responsibility that we need to recognize and honor. All chiropractors must learn to really understand functional neurology because at our core, that's really what we're about. It's what we've always been about. You don't have to do the research, but you really should know it. You really should read it. You really should be familiar with it. And you certainly need to support it because if we don't have research, really our future is going to be limited. You know, the thing that Brian showed yesterday, which really hit me, was that there were, if you remember, he said 2025, there were four possibilities, right? Remember? And the first possibility, does anybody remember what that was? I do. It was that we were going to be marginalized, right? And if we stay on the path of just being back doctors, That's exactly what's going to happen to us. We're just going to be marginalized therapists that are not going to be significant in any way. But on the bottom level, what he also said, the fourth possibility was that there'll be a modern vitalism, that we will lead the way. And also, there was one other thing that he said that was important to doing that, and it was research. And that's my whole mission, is really to lead that research and to be able to do that. All we need really is your support. When we talk about the human brain, the things that make it unique is that we have bipedalism. Bipedalism creates synchronization in our body, or the only way to be bipedal is to have synchronization in our body. That synchronization, it was transferred into our brain as part of evolution, and it is transferred to our brain as part of development. There's a famous statement called ontogeny recapitulates phylogeny, which means that child development is mini evolution. You just watch it. You see it from the very beginning. And part of that evolution is transferring motor binding, or being able to bind and coordinate motor networks on both sides of the body, and transferring that binding into the brain so we can now coordinate and synchronize our brain. And that builds the brain, and then the brain comes down and controls our body and has top-down control over every system, the immune system, the endocrine system, the autonomic system, the digestive system, the motor system, sensory processing. Motor binding and cognitive binding are one and the same. Cognitive binding is the way that we take all this information that's fragmented in our brain and bind it together. There is no one area where all of the information in the brain is dumped to. What binds it together is time. And that timing can be disrupted. We have all these different areas of our brain. That's also what makes the human brain unique. We have this asymmetry in our brain. And a lot of people will poo-poo the idea of right brain, left brain, because they really don't know what they're talking about. But everybody will admit that humans have the most asymmetric or lateralized brain. And for most humans, not all of them, we all know people that aren't, but for most humans, they're smarter than any other animal on the planet, right? So if that is the case, then we have to assume, and if we look at phylogenetic history or comparative anatomy, as you go up the animal kingdom, the animals get smarter as their brain becomes more coordinated, as they can activate more of their brain cells at the same time. And the more lateralized their brain becomes. So we have to see it as an advantage if we understand that. And it is a great advantage. It doesn't start out this way. When we start out our brain, it's pretty equal. And as our brain starts to evolve and develop, we start to differentiate. We start to specialize. And the reason that happens is because the right brain and the left brain develop at different stages. The right brain develops in the womb, and for the first 2 to 3 years of life, and then we switch to the left brain as primarily being developed, and then we switch back and forth. We do that throughout most of our childhood life and adolescence. And at each stage of that 2 to 3 year development, we have different experiences. We have different sensory input. We have different interactions. And it creates differences, gradual differences in the two hemispheres until, as we get to adults, they should be maximally differentiated. And it gives us an advantage because now we can mix and match those things together in all different unique ways, in limitless ways, so that the limits to human capacity and genius and intuition is limitless. And that's why we're always having people with new ideas. They combine different areas of their brain together in different ways that no one has ever done before. And that's really how we move humankind beyond. Somebody comes up with a unique idea, and that unique idea, if we were to measure that in the brain and say, what does that unique idea look like? It looks like a pattern of electrical activity in their brain that no one has ever actually done before. And then that unique pattern in their brain becomes that idea, becomes that concept, becomes a tool, becomes a lesson, and then they show it to the world, and then that pattern gets recreated in all of our brains, and it becomes part of human consciousness. And that's how we move forward. That's how we always move forward, from the time of developing a wheel. Someone thought of developing a wheel, right? So all of these things come together, and they control every aspect of the human body and brain. And the left brain and the right brain do very specific things or control specific things. And when you're doing a history and you're examining somebody, Nick and I were talking about this last night. What you need to do is go through and look at every aspect and every system of their body and ask them about it and look at it with a purpose, not just to hear what's going on, but to realize and to say, is there a link here? Are these all separate conditions? How many people come into your office and the only complaint they have is back pain or neck pain and headaches? How many people will say that people come into your office with only one complaint? How many people say when they come in, they have multiple complaints that usually involve multiple systems? When you have multiple complaints that involve multiple systems, there's only one thing that could really be the source of it all if they're related, and that's the brain, really. And so if you understand the patterns, what the right brain and what the left brain does, I won't go through all of them, but what you can do is if you read them, you realize that there are cognitive skills, there are academic skills, there are emotional aspects, there are aspects of behavior, there are motor functions, there are sensory functions. There are very specific things like different frequencies of light, different colors, different sounds, different frequencies of notes, different smells that affect the brain and that are processed by the brain differently, including, you know, things of how we regulate different hormones. The neurotransmitters are distributed differently. The left brain is primarily dopamine and acetylcholine. The right brain is serotonin and norepinephrine. So the idea of chemical imbalance is foolish to begin with because they aren't balanced to begin with. That's part of what makes the brain unique. The whole idea of chemical balances is something that, you know, has been discredited and continues. I'm writing a chapter right now in a textbook on the how the biochemistry or looking at the chemical imbalances in the brain doesn't work. It's a false theory. So what we see is that all of these things, including, you know, how we regulate hormones, how we regulate the immune system, the left brain activates the immune system, the right brain inhibits the immune system. This is the way the left brain and the right brain work with most things. The left brain governs approach behavior. The right brain governs avoidance or withdrawal behavior. So what we see is the left brain is more motor driven. The right brain is more sensory driven. The right brain is more looking for novelty and looking for things that are bad or that we haven't seen before that are potentially dangerous. The left brain is about familiarity and doing the same thing over and over. The left brain is impulsive by nature. It's motor. It's hyperactive. It's obsessive. It's compulsive. It likes to initiate an action and keep it going on and on and on and on and on and just repeating it. The left brain is the gas pedal. It's the get up and go. Positive emotions are really govern the left brain. So we have six primary categorical human emotions. Three of them are left brain, three of them are right. The three left are happy, anger, and surprise. The right is fear, anger, and disgust, and some people also put shame in there. And so what we see is that all of our emotions, everything is a balance of how we're interacting that. You can say, well, why would the left brain, why would anger be a positive emotion? Well, because the left brain is about seeking behavior. It's about going out in the world and seeking things. But while we're seeking, somebody has to watch our back, right? So the left brain is out there looking at everything. It looks at details. It looks at small pictures. It breaks everything up into little pieces, and it wants to line it all up into little pieces and look at it and calculate it out and predict a pattern. What's the pattern? Where is this going to go? Then it wants to break it up and do it again and break it up and do it again and memorize it and go back to it. And the right brain, while the left brain is doing this, the right brain is kind of looking around saying, okay, where's the danger coming from, right? Who's going to attack me? Let me just get the big picture. And let me just get a gut feeling of something doesn't feel right. I don't have time. I don't want to remember this. If it's bad, why do I want to remember it, right? I just want to react. I want to get the hell out of there. So if something bad comes along, the right brain says, okay, stop. Let's get out of here. If the left brain is doing something that's socially inappropriate, because the right brain is about building relationships, it's about building, it's about emotions, it's about reading emotions in ourselves and in others. So it says, okay, get out of here, or if you're doing the wrong thing or something that's socially inappropriate, it says stop, it's not working. If we're doing something repetitively, it says, okay, don't do that because I want to move on to something new. I'm getting bored with this right now and that's not useful right now. And so the left brain, it's not surprising that the left brain goes out and attacks infections or something going on in our body. The balance of TH1 and TH2 in our immune system, which really is the core of autoimmunity. Basically, any autoimmune problem comes down to an imbalance between TH1 and TH2. What regulates that imbalance? In large part, the brain does. So in autoimmune problems or hypersensitivities, if you're gluten sensitive, if you have patients that are gluten sensitive, there's two things that are absolutely not working. One is your digestive system, because gluten and other proteins like that shouldn't get through your body. You should be able to digest them. And your stomach lining, if you do get through, if it does get through, then the other thing that has to be dysfunctional is your immune system. Because if it does get through, your immune system should automatically recognize it as a good guy. I see you all the time. I see gluten all the time. I see dairy all the time. So I wouldn't react. So if you have a gluten sensitivity, it's always an abnormal reaction, and it always means that your gut's not working and your immune system's out of balance. Why would that be? Well, most common reason is because your brain's out of balance, especially if you have brain issues like ADHD, or you have, you know, depression or anxiety, or you have memory problems, or you have a learning disability. It's not coincidental. They're related to one another. So understanding how all of this works together is very important, and you need to make these questions part of what you do. Somebody comes in and says, you know, yeah, I'm kind of anxious, you know, I'm a little manic at times, and, you know, I'm worrying all the time. I have, you know, some people have said I have ADHD, and I probably had ADHD as a kid. You know, I have trouble sleeping at night and shutting my brain off. I have this right-sided neck pain. My back is hurting. I'm getting tennis elbow on my right arm, and I have this, you know, patellar tendonitis on my right side. And, you know, I find that I can't eat anything anymore. I'm sensitive to everything. I'm sensitive to gluten and dairy. And, you know, I did this blood test, and I have 40 food sensitivities. And I find that, you know, I have difficulty digesting. My stomach gets upset. I'm more constipated now than I ever was before. I notice that my armpit kind of sweats on this side and it doesn't sweat on the other. And then you look at the person. I'm going to show you some ways to identify this, and you look at some of their physical findings, and you realize that what Jay just described was a right brain deficit. And all of those things are related to one problem, and that you need to address that one problem. And it doesn't matter how you do it. It doesn't matter whether it's SOT, whether it's Columbia adjusting, or whether it's AK. What you need to do is get that right brain working. That's what your job is. It's not to clear out subluxations. It's to be able to get their brain and their body and their nervous system to work properly. So that we see that if we have right hemisphere under activation, we look at that as autism, Asperger's, ADHD, Tourette's, OCD. I mean, I can describe every aspect of what Tourette's is and what OCD is. And I've written 2 chapters alone on basal ganglionic function this year, and 1 paper on basal ganglia and hemispheric relationships. I could spend a whole weekend just talking about that. Suffice to say that it's there, it's real, and it happens. This is in my book, by the way, this list, but you see that it involves motor skills, poor attention, impulsivity, hyperactivity, lack of self-awareness, poor spatial orientation, poor nonverbal communication, poor eye contact, inappropriate social behavior, emotionally reactive, anxiety, misses the big picture, perseverative, OCD, poor reading comprehension and pragmatic skills, poor math reasoning, and an overactive immune system. So it affects every system. I can also go through what it does to the endocrine system and the balance of hormones between estrogen and testosterone. In my book, Autism, I describe how, you know, an imbalance in the brain can create primarily an imbalance in the sympathetic or parasympathetic nervous system, and I'm going to describe that in a second. And that can explain almost every nutritional, hormonal, immunological problem that people have. Left hemisphere, things like fine motor, poor reading. This is dyslexia. But you see that it involves every aspect of human behavior. In this paper here that we published in Reviews in Neuroscience in 2009, it was called the first universal theory of autism. It was the first theory that took every aspect of autism and described it in all of the symptoms under one model, which was this hemispheric functional disconnection model, in which we showed that all of the symptoms of autism, all of their strengths and all of their weaknesses. The thing that stands out about autism and ADHD, if you start reading the literature on them, is an unevenness of skills, meaning that they have certain areas of their brain and their body that are too strong, and they have other areas that are way too weak. And the more the imbalance, the more severe the problem is. And it's been shown through research, and I'll show you some of that, that correlates with synchronization. That the more synchronized the two hemispheres are, the less the symptoms of autism are, and the better their language ability is. The more desynchronized, the worse the symptoms are, and the less their language ability is. We also showed that we've done the research to show that there is this actual electrical imbalance in the brain, where we have what we call poor temporal coherence, that the two hemispheres are not synchronized, are not coordinating, and that the reason why they're not coordinating is because the left hemisphere is too active and the right hemisphere is too inactive. So what happens is both hemispheres have a processing speed. It's like an old computer and a new computer, right? You have two computers. You have one that has a really fast Pentium chip, and you have another one that has an old Pentium chip from like 5, 6, 7 years ago. And they both work independently. One works a lot slower than the other, right? But you physically connect them to one another, but they can't work together. Why can't they work together? Is there something broken? No, they both work, but why can't they work together? Can you see a problem? No. The problem is they're just different speeds. They're different processing speeds. They're not compatible with one another. And that's what's happening in most of the disorders that humans are struggling and suffering from, in adults and in children. The question really is this something that has been there since childhood, or is this something that developed later on in life? How do you know that? Well, if you do a good exam and you look at things like primitive reflexes and cross-laterality, if there's a mixed dominance profile, and if they have primitive reflexes, whatever you see in front of you started as childhood. And if you don't go back to their childhood and do something about those primitive reflexes, you're never going to get them to their optimum health. Never. But if you go back and you see they don't have primitive reflexes, they don't have cross-laterality, chances are this came later. And so then it's a slightly different approach, or maybe a greatly different approach, depending on what you know. But looking at the developmental history is very important. So again, we showed that this electrical relationship, we're now doing it with tensor diffusor imaging and connectography and fMRI. They're doing a study right now on my book, an independent study at one of the leading labs in the world at Harvard on my book. And they're doing brain imaging before and after, just doing some simple exercises like the ones I described in Disconnected Kids. This was a paper and a chapter we published with the same data looking at dyslexia and showed that the same exact relationship exists except for it's reversed, where the left hemisphere was delayed and the right hemisphere was advanced, but there was poor temporal coherence between the hemispheres. Functional neurological imbalances in the brain that we can measure and that we can see and that we have seen, they affect everything. They affect the somatosensory system, muscle tone. They affect the balance of anterior and posterior compartment and right and left. This is what leads to things like rotator cuff and tennis elbow. It has to do with bipedalism, meaning that if we go back and look at quadrupeds on all fours have completely different muscles that they emphasize. Most of them are anterior muscles here and posterior muscles here. And to stand upright, we have to actually activate the opposite muscles. We have to activate these muscles and these muscles. Otherwise, we can't stand upright. But through, you know, hundreds of years of evolution with millions of years of evolution with quadrupeds, these muscles tend to dominate. These muscles tend to be bigger than these muscles. These muscles tend to be bigger than these muscles. So the brain must be very strong to allow this to happen. If it doesn't happen on one side or the other, we get angulation of our arm. We get angulation. We lose this relationship. We lose this evolutionary battle that our brain helps us overcome. And when we inhibit a muscle, when we activate this muscle, we inhibit the opposite muscle. Anytime anybody has tendonitis, it is always because the muscle the tendon is attached to is inhibited, and they can't recruit it fully. The question is, why can't they recruit it fully? Why is it being inhibited? And it's usually being inhibited because of the opposite muscle. Well, why is that muscle contracted? Usually because the way the brain is controlling those muscles. And if you have a muscle that's inhibited and more force is pushed into the tendon where it's not supposed to be, we get tendonitis. So if you've treated somebody for tennis elbow or rotator cuff or patellar tendonitis, you've actually treated a brain problem. And you may not have known it, especially if it was all on the same side. How many people have done that? How many people have seen tendonitis in the upper and lower extremity on the same side and treated it? Right, okay, that was a brain problem, just so you know. Did you treat the brain? I don't know. If you got them better, you may have, but wouldn't it be better if you did it in a way that you knew that? Endocrine metabolic imbalances. Again, real quickly, an imbalance in the brain. Decreased activity on one side or the other causes an imbalance in sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. Increasing sympathetic tone. This is well documented. Increase in sympathetic tone has a number of different effects. On the digestive system, it causes reduced blood flow to the gut, reduced peristalsis, reduced secretions. We produce less hydrochloric acid. We produce less digestive enzymes. And this ultimately leads to a leaky gut and malabsorption syndromes. What it also does is it raises cortisol levels. As we raise cortisol levels, we increase blood sugar into the bloodstream. As we raise blood sugar levels to the bloodstream, we end up getting insulin resistance because the receptors that lose their sensitivity, that bring sugar into our cells, they become less sensitive. So then we get more insulin surges to get more release of sugar. Insulin surges causes an upregulation of different hormones. In women, it causes an upregulation of an enzyme called 17:20 lyase, which converts estrogen to testosterone. So in stress, when we have stress on our body, or when we have an increased sympathetic tone, or we have decreased inhibition of our sympathetic tone, just because your brain isn't working, you have an increased testosterone. It was just a paper that just came out 2 days ago, another paper showing that elevated testosterone and cortisol is present in children with autism and in their mothers. Why? That's why. Because their brain is out of balance. Because their brain isn't regulating the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. In men, it causes the opposite. It causes an upregulation of an enzyme called aromatase, and it converts testosterone to estrogen. So what happens if you have somebody whose body is converting testosterone to estrogen, you give them a testosterone patch? You create more estrogen. So is giving people with low T testosterone the right answer? No, the answer is to get their brain working properly. And then you don't have to give them that. And if you give them that, you're actually going to make them more into female. So you're going to have gynecomastia and things like that, which we see all the time. So all of these things are interrelated. Imbalances within the vestibular system, within the postural system. This is how we create the baseline aspect of who we are in space. We build maps in our brain in the superior and inferior colliculus based on this input as to who we are and where we are. So we get body tilts forward, backward, right, left. You have a head tilt to the right. You have a body tilt to the right. You have a rotation of your head one way or the other with the tilt. You lean forward, or you have a tendency to lean back. A lot of this is because the way that your brain has built your maps as to where you are. If your brain feels like you're falling forward because your spatial maps are sending in mixed signals from your otolis and your semicircular canals that make your body feel like your center of gravity is forward, what happens is you get up and walk on your toes. So kids that walk on their toes, it's not because of any, you know, gravitational thing per se. It's because their body, their brain feels like they're forward. If you have a head tilt to the right, it's because your brain feels like your center of gravity is here, because the signals it's getting from your muscle spindles are telling you that you're leaning one way more than the other, or you're falling one way more than the other. And so we get contractions of muscles to counteract those falls. And you can see some of this with posturography. As we said, imbalances in the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system can really explain almost every hormone, neurological, an immunological imbalance that we have in our body because of what it does. This was, I know that some of you, if you use Richard's equipment looking at heart rate variability, it's a great thing to look at sympathetic and parasympathetic tone. We actually just published a paper, which is the defining, we just created a whole software, we created a way of looking through spectral analysis at looking at heart rate variability. That's the most sophisticated way to do it. Why are we doing it? Because part of what we look at are kids with autism and people in comas. And looking at their autonomic system is very, very important. And finding ways of really looking at that without them telling us what's happening is very important. So we just came up with the best way to do that. This is a paper that, like I said, really kind of defines everything. Autism spectrum disorder is a functional disconnection. It's a universal theory, and basically it shows that if you have a brain deficit, like a right brain deficit, that it can create all these different increases on one side and decreases on the other, and that it also causes an imbalance in the sympathetic and parasympathetic system. And if you look at all of the most common, and these are only really not even close to even all of them, but if you look at all of these different things that we see that mostly is treated or that they talk about in functional medicine or in biomedical treatments, all of these things, all of the vitamin deficiencies, all the immune issues, all of the cytokines, all of the inflammation, all of the different issues that you see can be described simply by looking at an imbalance with increased sympathetic tone and decreased parasympathetic tone. So that decreased activity in the brain causes, you know, decreased projections and activations of the vagal system, of the parasympathetic system, which then causes decreased intestinal blood flow, decreased intestinal motility, which leads to increased yeast overgrowth, increased bacteria. We also get reduction in, we change the pH of the gut because we don't produce hydrochloric acid. And when we change the pH of the gut, we then lead to yeast overgrowth and fungal overgrowth. We also can't absorb B12 or folic acid if we don't have intrinsic factor or hydrochloric acid in our gut. And it also affects the immune activation within the gut. We lose secretory IgA, and we lose our ability to recognize self from other. And this is the nature of autoimmunity. It's a balance of TH1 and TH2. Aristo Vajani, who is really one of the leading experts in the world, he lectures every year at our IAFNR conference. He also started Cyrex Labs, and he can test things that almost no one can test. And what we see is that the problem with toxins in the body, the problem with gluten, the problem with mercury, is not actually the toxicity of the chemical itself, but rather that we actually develop antibodies against that. So that he was saying that, I just did an interview with him on our website last week, and he was saying that what they're finding is that pesticides, even under, you know, high washing conditions, that the pesticides, it's not that the pesticides are on the fruit, but the pesticide binds with the protein in the fruit, and then it becomes a different protein. And when you eat that, your body doesn't recognize that protein. It looks at the fruit protein and the pesticide as a new single protein, and we develop antibodies against it. And now when we eat that food, we get an antibody reaction. It's an immune reaction. And especially if our immune system is way too strong and if our digestive system isn't working properly. So that, you know, being able to create a balance between them is part of what you're doing with nutrition. Vitamin D is one of the most important things you can do to balance out TH1 and TH3, and also the brain. So how do we assess these imbalances? Well, you have a good developmental history. How many of you actually ask and say, did you have ADHD as a kid? Did you have a learning disability? Did you have any problems with reading? Did you have ADHD? Looking at their attachment to their family, to their parents, looking at primitive reflexes, looking at their dominance profile, looking at a physical exam and lab testing. This is how we develop from primitive reflexes to sensory motor. Then we develop cognitive, then we develop academics, and behavior and academic learning is built on top of that. There are different things that you can look at when you look at head tilts, for instance. These are things that are in my book, both books. that you can look at head tilts. Tilt to the right, usually, not always, but most of the time, is going to signify a right brain deficit. This was the cover of Time magazine with an autism, which is a right brain deficiency. So in adults, looking at a right brain deficit, so when you look at them, you look to see, is their head tilted to the right? That's one way of looking at it. Then look at the eye and see if they have one eye that's literally larger than the other. Do they have what we call a scleral show, where they have white part of their eye that can be seen, where one eye literally looks bigger than the other? Usually that big eye is on the side of right brain because it signifies weakness of the facial muscles. Same thing with looking at an anisocoria or a pupillary imbalance. Is there a difference between the size of the pupils? Usually a larger pupil is going to be on the side of a brain deficit, especially if it's on the same side where the eye is larger or where the head is tilted to. You're going to look at facial muscles. You look at the nasal labial fold and look and see if there's a difference in the depth. It's usually shallower on the side of weakness, right? Think about it. What do we do to get rid of wrinkles? Botox. What does Botox do? Paralyzes muscles. The size of paresis of muscles is the side with a less crease or less wrinkles, even in their forehead as well. Here's an example right off of TV. That's a brain weakness right there. Can all of you see it? The key is, what's the problem side here, right? The side on that side, that eye is bigger. There's no crease on this side. The corner of his mouth is drooped down on that side. And if he had a head tilt and a head rotation, then we know that, you know, this is a right brain deficit that we're looking at here. Here's the cover of a Scientific American Mind magazine. And they show a brain deficit right on the cover. Unbelievable. Look at that. Look at the size of the right eye compared to the left. Look at the nasal labial fold. Look at the mouth. Right? So right there in someone's face, it's there. You look at the soft palate, you have them go, ah. You'll see that one side may rise higher than the other when they go, ah, 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 ah. And the side that is down is usually on the side of brain weakness. You look at their tongue deviation, have them stick their tongue out. It usually goes, again, when they stick their tongue out, it's going to deviate usually towards the weak muscle. So they usually will deviate towards the side of a brain weakness. You look at shoulder in rotation, which is affecting these muscles. How do you know that? If someone's hand is facing forward, that's a shoulder in rotation. Their thumb should be facing forward. If they got one thumb this way, one hand this way, this shoulder is in rotated. It's usually on the same side of a brain weakness. Angulation of the limbs, as we were talking about before. This is why we get tennis elbow. This is why we get rotator cuff, because this pec is contracted, this bicep is contracted, the brachioradialis is more contracted, and we get angulation of our wrist and our hand, which ultimately can lead to carpal tunnel on that side. You can test to see if there's a weakness of extensors of the toe and the thumb. Usually, this is the thumb, obviously, and being able to extend it is one of the things that makes us most uniquely human, right? So when this is weak, when we can't extend it, it's usually related to a problem or a weakness, a functional problem in the brain. Same thing with the large toe. The toe, the fingers and the toes are really the greatest expression of the cortex itself. So these are some things that you can go back with tomorrow or Monday and start to look at and get an idea. And again, I have these in both of my books that you can look at them more. I teach a course, and I'd love to have you, you know, attend the course. If you really want to learn this at the highest level, you can contact the Carrick Institute, or you can go to iafner.com, or you can go to my website, drrobertmelillo.com. But the idea is, what we want to do is not even our job isn't really to correct a brain imbalance. It's not to correct subluxations. It's really to promote integration. The brain, when it's working properly, is integrated, and it integrates all of these systems and everything together. So our job is to do that, and it is a product of timing and coordination. If we don't have timing and coordination in our body, we can't have it in our brain. If we don't have it in our brain, we won't have it in our body. So one of the easiest and most dramatic ways to change the coordination and the integration in the brain is to restore coordination into the body through doing different types of gait training, gaze stabilization, balance, proprioceptive input, and restoring timing and rhythm, or even timing and rhythm type activities. It's important to understand that when we talk about integration, we have first and foremost what we call vertical integration. It starts from the bottom up, and then it comes from the top down. And what we see is that, like, when we look at children with reading problems, learning disabilities, or when we talk about, you know, traditional psychotherapy or talk therapy, one of the problems is the reason why they don't work very well in kids with these issues is because they're top-down therapies. They're trying to engage their frontal lobe when they never built a frontal lobe to begin with. And if you have primitive reflexes and cross-laterality, they never built their frontal lobe. And especially if it's asymmetric, then they built it on one side and not the other. And so you can't use frontal lobe activities. That's why doing things like, you know, cognitive skills and neurofeedback is good, especially in adults, if you have a brain, if you have a frontal lobe. If you're doing EEG biofeedback and this person has primitive reflexes, guess what? It's not going to work. Because you have to fix that first before you can actually get that to work. And then we need to look at horizontal integration, which is getting both sides of the brain to work together through physical connectivity and through temporal connectivity. Again, effects of this is some of the research we've done to prove this. We're looking at, you know, effects of contralateral extremity manipulation on brain function. We've shown that you can change brain function on one side by manipulating the other side. Looking at, again, fixing things like Landau-Kleffner syndrome by doing a multimodal hemispheric-based approach. This was another one looking at postural and cognitive abilities in ADHD, that there's a relationship, and that restoring posture also reduces ADHD. This is looking at the doing timing and rhythm type therapy. These are all papers that we published on the effects of hemisphere-specific remediation strategy. This showed that in 80% of kids that came through our brain balance centers, that in 12 weeks, they no longer had ADHD. 80% no longer had ADHD after 12 weeks. We then followed that up with a with an independent study that was just came out in the Frontiers in Public Health last year, in a control study where we did a controlled randomized study, and we showed the same thing, that children that went through our program looking at a hemispheric-based program, that 81% of them after 12 weeks no longer had ADHD. Kids that didn't go through our program at the end of 12 weeks when they were the controls, they still had ADHD, and if anything, their ADHD scores actually got worse by their parents' own scoring, a behavioral health checklist. We also see furthermore that there was a 2 to 4 grade level increase in academic achievement in that period of time. So that it's not just relieving symptoms, it's changing their brain. These are some of the things that we can show you, again, before and after. This is the same child. Again, I encourage you that if you really want to do this, if you want to treat brains, and you're gonna go out there and have a brain-based practice, we have to speak from reality, and you really should have some credentials, right? The easiest way and quickest way is for you to get some credentials. So then people say, you know, why? What gives you the idea that you should be, you know, brain-based practice? Well, one thing you can say, I'm a member of the International Association of Functional Neurology and Rehab, and I attend their conference every year, and I get their journal every month. Would that be a good way to start, you think? Right? Okay, so you can do that easily. Go to iafner.com, become a member, you get a journal for free, right? Our journal is free. And come to our conference in Vegas in October. This is our journal, and this is our conference. I'm telling you that it is an unbelievably inspirational thing to be around. You will hear some of the top speakers. If you want to learn about the speakers, what I'm doing is I'm interviewing them on our website, and you can meet them. So we have people like Dan Siegel, who has a New York Times best-selling book right now. He's one of the leading people in attachment disorders in the world. Lou Cozzolino from Pepperdine University wrote a book called The Neuroscience of Psychotherapy. He's also one of the leading people in dissociation and attachment disorders from Harvard. We have Martha Herbert, who's one of the leading pediatric neurologists and one of the leading autism researchers in the world. We have Ted Carrick. We have another person from Montreal that's coming to speak. We have just workshops. We have clinical workshops as well. Datis Karazian, who's a chiropractic neurologist who also has a best-selling book. We have Ari Vajani, as I said, one of the leading immunologists in the world. We have just an incredible event, and we have a dinner and awards ceremony that is so inspirational because about a third of our organization are students, are chiropractic students. And when they're there, it is just, I mean, intense. They're so emotional. They're so excited. So if you want to do this, then you need to know something. You need to back it up. You need to have some credentials. And as I said, go to IAFNR. So if you just join, get the journal, read it, you know, on your at your own, and come to the conference, you then start to have the right to be able to do that. And you need to be able to support the research that we do. If you want to find out more about our Brain Balance Centers, you can also contact brainbalancecenters.com. Any one of you could own one. If you wanted, we have 80 right now in the United States, and we're growing rapidly. We get results that nobody else gets, and we built them that they don't do chiropractic because I didn't want them to compete with chiropractors in practice. We do everything that you're not going to do in your practice, primarily academic. They're learning centers. Anybody can own them. Right now, the people that are buying the most of them are parents of the kids that went through our program whose lives have been changed forever. So you can find out more about that if you want to. CNN just voted it one of the 5 hottest franchises in the United States to be a part of. And if you want more information, again, you can go to at Twitter at robmalillo.com. You can go to our webpage. We have a YouTube channel where you can view our TV shows, and hopefully soon we'll actually have a national TV show. Again, I want to thank you for your attention. I want to thank you for your time. I want to encourage you to continue your education. You know, again, you're in the right place. You have the right people here mentoring you. All you need to do is add a little bit of the science. Don't be afraid of it. And again, if I can ever be of service to any of you, I'm here. You can come to my courses. I'd love to see you, okay? Thank you very much.
Come on, let's hear it for Dr. Melillo.